All good. Thanks for your patience. Good afternoon, and welcome to Stokely Family Media Center in Neyland Stadium on this exciting day as we formally introduce Tennessee's new head football coach, Josh Heupel. Here's the format for today's press conference. We will bring up Vice Chancellor and Director of Athletics, Danny White, who will make some opening remarks and introduce Coach Heupel. Coach Heupel will make some opening remarks, and then we'll take questions for Coach. We'll then bring Danny back up, and he will take questions to conclude today's press conference. For those media members in the room, we ask that you please silence your mobile devices. For those joining us virtually, we ask that you please keep your devices muted until you are called on. For those in the room asking questions, we ask that you please do not grab the mic. We'll have someone provide the mic for you. Lastly, please share your name and affiliation prior to asking your question. It is now my pleasure to introduce the Vice Chancellor and Director of Athletics at Tennessee, Danny White.
Thanks, Bill. Appreciate you guys being here today. I think I've been on the job for 5 days, something like that. It's been a whirlwind, but proud to be at Tennessee and really excited about today. I want to welcome Josh, and you'll meet his wonderful family, Dawn, Hannah, and Jace, who we've rocked their world. They're in the same boat now as my family and. Family in transition, but really excited about having you all here as part of the Tennessee family and everything that we're excited about building here moving forward. I want to thank President Randy Boyd and Chancellor Donnie Plowman for their support throughout this search and for the last week, and couldn't be more excited about the opportunity for me personally to be here in the future of what we have going for Tennessee athletics and across this entire institution. Our football student athletes were phenomenal. They were really, really great. We have a special group. I want to thank the leadership committee I met with this past weekend. The insight they gave me on what's happening in our football program was absolutely instrumental in helping me identify the right leader that we have here in Josh Heupel of our football program moving forward. Had a great meeting with the team this morning, and I can tell you they're excited. They're ready to get to work, and they're really excited. We had an exhaustive nationwide search. I know that sounds crazy because I'm hiring the guy that I've worked with for the last 3 years. But if anything, I was trying not to hire the head coach from UCF. And I say that with respect to Tennessee, but I love UCF and I hate that the transition this is causing for those student athletes down there. That's the hard part of college athletics. After going through extensive candidates, we left no stone unturned. I'd like to thank the candidates. You'd be amazed if I could ever tell you, and I won't, how many candidates we spoke with, and there were no leaks until last night. Only two leaks I've been a part of in my career as an AD, and both of them happened in the last week. So we need to work on that here. We got to figure that one out. That'll be one of my top priorities as we go through here. But I really wanted the student athletes to find out first from me, and certainly I would want that for any group of student athletes. But obviously the student athletes at UCF, that it's a shame that it leaked. But we'll continue to work on that, tighten some things up. But we left no stone unturned. We talked to head coaches. We talked to coordinators. We talked to long-seasoned coaches. Talked to young up-and-coming coaches. Character and integrity were extremely important from the jump. Told you guys that last week and will continue to be. I have zero questions about that with this guy. We want to build a program that we can all be proud of. And after vetting every single option we had, I obviously landed with a familiar face. In Josh Heupel, he was our number one option. This job was offered to one person. I know that there's a lot of rhetoric out there to the contrary, and that's just not true. We made one job offer. We got our number one candidate. I couldn't be more proud to have Josh as our new head football coach. Josh is in it for the right reasons. He's student-athlete centered. That was his message to the team. This morning we filmed a video, so he was able to talk to his team at UCF in person, and we showed a video that he did for our team here at Tennessee. He cares about the kids. I've seen that for 3 years. He cares deeply about their development as students, as people, as athletes. They need to know that. Future recruits need to know that. That's what we're going to be about here at Tennessee in all of our sports. From a fan perspective and a AD's perspective, it's a pretty fun brand of football. It's one of the most innovative minds in all of college football. I'll talk about some of the statistics that they've accomplished. I'm kind of in the they-we still transition in terms of UCF and what's happened on the offensive side of the ball. Also one of, if not the best, developer of young quarterbacks in college football. His reputation speaks for itself, and what he's been able to accomplish as an offensive coach and a developer of quarterbacks. We want to build the foundation of a program, as I mentioned last week, in all of our sports, but we're talking about football here today, and we want to compete for Southeastern Conference and for national championships. I told our student athletes I wouldn't share publicly much of what they shared with me about what was happening in our program for a lot of reasons. We had a great confidential conversation, but I think they'll be okay with me sharing with you that some characteristics they're looking for in a head coach. They talked about a little bit of confidence, a little bit of juice, and a little bit of swagger. And that's something that we have in spades, and they'll continue to have at UCF and their football program. And that's something that you'll see in Josh Heupel, the staff that he'll build here, and how we carry ourselves as a football program. Kids are excited. It's going to be fun. It's going to be exciting. I think you guys are going to like the brand of football you see. Just some highlights that you could probably read, but I'll just touch on a couple highlights. At UCF for the last 3 years is the only team in the country to rank them up among the top five in total offense for every single year of the last three seasons. It's the only team in the country to average at least 522 yards of total offense in each of the last three seasons. UCF and Alabama are the only two teams to rank among the top eight in the country in passing each of the last two seasons. Along with Alabama and USC, the only three teams in the country to average at least 316 passing yards in the last two seasons. They join Alabama, Clemson, and Oklahoma as the only four teams in the country to rank among the top eight in scoring in the last three seasons. And finally, they join Alabama and Clemson as the only teams in the country to average at least 42 points per game in each of the last three seasons. It's pretty good company to be included with from an offensive standpoint. Obviously, there's a lot more to the game than offense. Josh knows that. He's going to build a big-time staff. We're excited about supporting him from this day forward have a top-notch staff across the board and compete. And he can speak way better than I can about overall plans in terms of team success, not just offense. But I'm hearing a lot of feedback from our fans about they want offense. I don't know how we could deliver offense more than we just did. We're going to move the ball and score some points around here, and I couldn't be more excited about it. And I'll share with you, I got that same sentiment from the group of student athletes I met with, and they were pretty jacked up after our meeting this morning. Most importantly, and we're about student athlete success, as I talked about last week. The success of the UCF football team under Josh's leadership was accompanied with unparalleled success in the classroom. Last two semesters, the football program down there had two of the highest GPAs ever, over 3.0. 60% of the roster right now is carrying a GPA over 3.0 under Josh's leadership. As I mentioned, he does it the right way, encouraging kids to compete in the classroom, compete on the field, and we want to make them the best versions of themselves. And they have my commitment across all of our sports. We're going to continue to do that. So without further ado, I'll turn it over to the guy you guys want to hear from today and introduce your new head football coach, Josh Heupel. The 27th in the history of Tennessee football. They got the name on there, too.
We got it right. What an awesome day for myself and our family, and so appreciative of the warm welcome that we've received, and just excited to be a part of the Vol Nation, Vol family. I want to thank Chancellor Pluman and President Boyd for your vision of what you want and foresee in athletics, the importance that it has on a collegiate campus, and entrusting me and our family, but entrusting us to mentoring and teaching these young men the game of life, not just the game of football. To Danny, obviously those same sentiments, but having been around each other for 3 years, believing in the process that we take our kids through and understanding what we're trying to accomplish on the football field. We want to go chase championships. We want to be at our absolute best. At the same time, we want to develop them in life too. And appreciate you guys entrusting us with the care of this program and these young men and individuals. When I was talking with Chancellor Plowman last night, one of the things that just registered with me and made this job opportunity so exciting is the aligned vision between leadership with everybody sitting here today. And we talked about the importance of having a shared common vision, being able to work at our purpose to accomplish those things every single day, and everybody pulling the rope the same direction. And when you have that in leadership, that's going to transcend through in your entire campus and hopefully throughout our entire state here in Tennessee. And when you do those things, great things are capable of happening. And obviously, I'm here because we have the opportunity to go chase championships on the football field. I also want to take this time to thank my wife, Dawn, my co-pilot in life. She's probably piloting most of the time when I'm at the office. My beautiful daughter, Hannah, and my son, Jace. They woke up to a changed world today. They were excited. There were a few tears maybe at the beginning of the day, but excited once they saw the orange tee on the plane. They were ready to jump on top and or jump in and get here. Jace is excited. I was texting with Peyton Manning earlier, and he's waiting on counting down the days until he's able to catch a ball from him out on the game field. That was his first ask as we got on the plane. So I want to thank the players and the staff at UCF. Last 3 years have been a tremendous journey, a tremendous ride. I appreciate them allowing me as their coach to be a part of their individual journey and accomplish so many great things. So proud of who and what we were as a program. So excited to see their success this year. Just great leadership inside of the locker room. And when you have great leadership from within, all things are possible. And appreciate each and every one of them. One of the things that also registered with me is I was talking with the leadership here last night on a Zoom call, was Danny's conversation with the leadership council and the football team, and the things that they are focused on accomplishing. That's why they came here to one of the biggest and best brands in college football. But the things that they feel like they want to make sure that the locker room, that they have inside of the locker room. And at the end of the day, it came down to connection. And that's one of the things that's extremely important to me. It's been really hard during this past year with COVID, but you play this game. It's a tough, physical, demanding game. You play it because of connection. And there's got to be a sense of belonging, a sense of brotherhood that has to reside inside of that locker room. And to do that, you got to spend time with each other. And you have to do things outside of the game. And that's one of the things that we try to pride ourselves on inside of our program here at Tennessee as we move forward, is that sense of connection. And that allows you to go chase greatness outside of the game. When you are connected, you have a chance for love. When you have love, you're able to sacrifice for your teammates. And this game is all about sacrifice. And accountability is something that we talked about as well, and making sure that we're being accountable to each other, the program, the process, and the people that reside inside of it. On the offensive side of the football, Danny mentioned some of the successes that we have had as a program at UCF and throughout my tenure. We're going to play with tempo here. We're going to be the aggressor. We're going to play with our skilled players out in space. We're going to give them an opportunity to push the football down the field. At the same time, if you really watch what we do, we're extremely balanced in our approach as far as running pass. We want to be physical. We want to dominate the line of scrimmage. Those are all things that are going to translate to what we're doing here in Knoxville. At the same time, that aggressive mentality that we have on the offensive side of the football is going to carry over to what we're doing on the defensive side of the football as well. We'll be multiple in all fronts, three-man, four-man fronts. We're going to bring pressure. We want to create negative plays. I think in the game of college football, offensively it's about creating big plays. Defensively it's about creating negative plays and getting people off schedule. You put those two things together, you got a chance to have a really successful game plan and ultimately a season. And excited about embarking down that road as we get together as a football program here after this. I think one of the things that's extremely important to the lifeblood of any program, but to the lifeblood here at Tennessee, is recruiting. And that's one of the great things here is that you have a national name, national logo that allows you to go coast to coast and go attract the biggest, the best, and the brightest. At the same time, the most important thing that we do is lock down our borders. We have to keep kids inside of this state here. And that's for multiple reasons. They're going to come play championship caliber football. They're going to be developed. They're going to have an opportunity to move on to the NFL. They're going to get a great degree. And they're going to be empowered to live inside of the state once they are done with that degree. But we have to do that inside of, of our own borders. And that's going to come for me, a focus on the recruiting in-state for me. It's got to transcend through our assistant coaching staff. But it's also got to reside in every every Vol fan here inside the state of Tennessee. And I say that meaning that everybody's got to bring energy and passion, create and sustain a positive movement through everything that we're doing to create the sustainable change that we need to lock down the borders here with our recruits. Excited about what we're embarking on, excited to be a part of Vol Nation, excited to do my very best for the state of Tennessee every single day. I promise you that our staff will do the exact same thing, and I promise you that we're going to embark on going to become what we're capable of as a football program day by day and go chase championships and win those championships. With that, I'm going to open it up for some questions.
We'll start here in the room, and reminder, please state your name and affiliation. We'll start with Jimmy.
Jimmy Himes with Sports Animal in Knoxville. How soon do you feel like you need to put together a staff, and will you consider staff members from Central Florida?
We'll consider staff members from Central Florida. We'll do that. Also, current members on this staff, we'll have a conversation with them here, the members here at Tennessee. It's important that we put together a staff at the right time, that we get the right people, more than it is simply about the urgency of putting that staff together. But yes, we want to do it in a timely fashion.
Go to David here in the front.
David, I'm with The Athletic. When you sort of look at this roster right now, what is your message to guys that are, you know, considering going in the portal and guys that are already in there? And of course, could you envision a scenario bringing players from UCF here?
I will not recruit players off of a roster that I was a part of. Don't believe that's the right thing to do. To the current members of this football program and this roster, we need to be a family. We need to act like a family. And everybody's got a different perspective based on their background of what a family is at times. When you sit in front of your team and there's 105 guys, you know, in front of you, everybody's got a little bit different perspective. But at the end of the day, a family to me is defined when push comes to shove, that family stays together. Let's stay a family. Let's trust the people that are in place to help you become what you're capable of. You chose this university for the right reasons, and I'm saying have a chance to be an elite football program. The tradition says that it should be. It's our job to get it back to that level. You're going to get an elite education and be in one of the best communities in college football. You walk out inside of that stadium. I've played here, or coached here, I should say. That's an electric stadium. There's not a better atmosphere in college football. Cannot wait to walk out to that post-COVID next fall and hear Rocky Top being played as we're running out. You know, that I just got goosebumps thinking about it. All those things are still here. Trust me, our leadership, who I'm going to bring in, give us a chance, all right, for our family to become connected. Let's go have fun together. Work hard, but let's have fun together and compete.
Jordan.
Hi, Josh. Jordan Kramer with WATE-TV. With this investigation ongoing into Tennessee football and therefore the outcomes, kind of maybe some penalties that may be handed down, not known at this time, how much did that ultimately factor into your decision? And then because you are here, standing here right now, why did it not deter you from this job?
Yeah, I had a very frank conversation with every person of leadership about what had transpired, what their knowledge is. What they believe is going to transpire as far as any penalty. And the reason that I'm standing here today is because I believe in a very, very, very bright future for Tennessee football. I believe that there's a minor speed bump that that we're going through, but the kids that are in our program right now and the kids that are being recruited are all going to have an opportunity to go play and chase championships.
Go to Patrick.
Patrick Brown with 24/7 Sports. Josh, you talked a lot about your offensive philosophy. How would you kind of describe your background and how your schemes and the way you've played has changed over your years at Oklahoma, Utah State, Missouri, and at UCF?
Yeah, at the end of the day, you become a culmination of everything that you've done. But you really do change year to year based on what your personnel is. That's who your quarterback is, what your skill set is there. Who are the skill players around him, whether you're going to play in, you know, three wide receiver sets, four wide receiver sets, or you're going to be in two tight end sets. We've played in all of those things. It comes down to always looking at, and this is, I think it's critical on the offense side of the ball, but it's the same thing I'm going to talk to our defense staff and our special team staff about, is don't look at what kids can't do. Look at what they can do at a high level and put them in a position of success. That is a coach's job. That, you know, understand who your players are and put them in a position of success. And so we'll base what we do offensively as far as our personnel groupings and some of the subtle schemes based on what our personnel is. But it's grown and changed throughout the years for sure.
Blake in the back.
Hey, Josh. Blake Topmeyer, Knoxville News Sentinel. Kind of a follow-up to that question. Your scheme is obviously fair bit different than what Tennessee was doing. How do you go about establishing that new system in one off season? And then specifically with the staff, is Kevin Steele someone you would like to keep on the staff going forward?
I'm going to have a conversation with everybody that's on staff. I'll touch on that question first. I think that's important. The first question was the temple portion of it, how you install it.
Installing your scheme in one off season.
Yeah, we've done it successfully multiple times, different places that I've been. Your coaches have to get caught up to speed on what you're doing if they haven't been inside of the system. You got to coach your coaches, and then your coaches got to put in time with your players. And there's only one way to get to where you need to be, and that's time, effort, and energy, right? And our players have to be willing to go above and beyond to get where we need to be. We will be able to get there, no question in my mind, as we get into spring ball through summer workouts, and by the time we get to the end of training camp, we'll be in a good position by the time we hit the ground in fall.
We'll take some virtual questions. We'll start with Dennis Dodd, CBS.
Hey, Josh, congratulations. I wonder, big picture, if you could just, in retrospect, what did the firing at Oklahoma in 14 mean to you and mean to your career?
Give me a chance in some ways, Dennis, just to kind of restart and relook at what I wanted to do on the offensive side of the football. And as a coordinator, you're always going to try to carry out your head coach's vision. There were a lot of things we did successfully. I think we were top 10 in the country in offense that year, playing with a freshman quarterback that maybe started, you know, last two-thirds of the season, ran into a buzzsaw in a bowl game against a really good Clemson football team. But it gave me an opportunity just to reshift my focus on what I wanted to be as far as an identity on the offensive side of football.
We'll go to Mike Wilson virtually.
Yeah, hey Josh, Mike Wilson from the Knoxville News Sentinel. I'm just curious what the challenges are of being hired in late January opposed to coming in, you know, typically in November as a new hire. So what challenges do you expect with signing day coming up fast and spring football coming up fast?
Yeah, the toughest part is getting a hold on what your roster actually is, what are the needs, and you know, signing day being as close as it is, are those vacancies that you want to fill? Do you want to hold them? It's a different landscape now, too, because of the transfer portal, and we talked about that as far as our own roster here. But junior college football is taking place this spring as well. So as you get through spring ball, you potentially are going to need to fill some spots on your roster at that time as well. It's a little bit different cycle, unique than what it has been in the past.
One more question virtually. Mike Bianchi.
Yeah, Coach, Mike Bianchi, Orlando Sentinel. I'm wondering, you talked about a football team as a family. Well, the family down here lost the head of the family. How did your players handle it? Were you able to talk to them? And also, is being able to compete for championships at the highest level, did that have anything to do with your decision?
Got an opportunity to talk with our football team in Orlando this morning. It was important to me that we did that. At the same time, created a video message for our new football team here in Knoxville. And they were able to, simultaneously as I was having that conversation with them, receive a message from me. What I saw is the future of Tennessee football and things that are important inside of our culture. I love the players in Orlando. It was a hard morning. I said that about my kids when they found out that their home was going to change. They're excited now, too. But that was a tough conversation because you care deeply about the people that you're pouring a lot of time and energy into, as we did. I think for my family and I coming here, it's because we believe in this university. We believe in this football program. We believe in the leadership that we have here in place, and it's clearly aligned. And there's a direct correlation to that alignment and the ability for me to go do my job at the highest level.
We'll come back to the room here, to the middle, and Brent.
Brent Hubbs, VolQuest.com. Two questions. What did you learn in the 2 years at Missouri about the SEC and kind of how you have to play football here? Is it any different than at UCF or anywhere else? And two, how do you feel like you've grown the last 3 years the most as a head coach, CEO, leader of a program, beyond just being a play caller?
Yeah, I think your communication skills and how clear your communication has to be, not with your football coaches, but with every support staff group that interacts with your players to give them the best opportunity to be successful. I think that's the number one thing as I've looked back on the last 3 years, that I'm in a better place today than I was before. Your initial question was
just what you learned
SEC,
in your first stint in the SEC about maybe playing
in
this.
Well, I think the line of scrimmage in this league is different than it is in other leagues, right? So you got to do a great job of recruiting, developing those guys. That size, strength matters up front. You got to do a great job. You're going to face elite pass rushers in this league, and so you got to do a great job of protecting your quarterback as well, just from an offensive standpoint. But I think the line of scrimmage is the biggest difference.
The coach's far right, Trey.
Trey Wallace, Fox Sports Knoxville. Your relationship with Danny and the years that you've spent with him, was there ever a thought process in your mind that when he took the job here, maybe somehow you ended up in Knoxville? And what have you learned from Danny and y'all's relationship over the last 3 years that you think you can bring here to Knoxville to better this institution?
Yeah, when Danny got the job, was disappointed that he wasn't going to be there anymore. We had a conversation after it went public and wished him well, and that was really the end of that conversation. Didn't think about this opportunity in that way. I think as a football coach, you're typically just living in the environment that you're in. You're so encapsulated in that. That's your sole focus that you don't think outside of those things. I think for Danny and I, there's for me, and I don't want to speak for him, but there's great comfort in coming here and knowing exactly what you're getting out of the leader that you deal with the most. There's a clear vision of what he wants for the student-athlete experience, which is extremely important, and a clear vision of what he wants as an athletic department as a whole. And there's a lot of entities inside of our program here that are doing extremely well. You look at our basketball programs. It's my job to make sure that we're getting this built to the level where we can go chase championships every year too.
Up front here to Rick.
Trey kind of asked the same question I was going to ask, but first of all, welcome to town and to you and your family. And Rick Russo, by the way, WVLT News. But yeah, is there a sense of comfortability for you knowing that Danny is here and the big vision for you, for UT football, sustained success? Talk about that and how important that is to you.
Yeah, we had a conversation. What are we looking for and how are we trying to build this? And it's a long-term vision, right? I believe that we can have immediate success as well. We got really good players inside of that locker room. You know, I've watched a little bit of tape, or I've seen them in recruiting. There's good players in there. It's our job as a coaching staff to get them ready to go play their absolute best and go compete every Saturday. But at the same time, there's a long-term vision of what we're trying to build here for sustainable success and a clear vision of how we're trying to do that.
One more question in the room here, and then we'll go back virtually. David.
Hey, Coach. David Shealy with WBIR. Danny talked about how you're a great developer of young quarterbacks. What qualities does a quarterback need to have to be successful in your system?
We've had different guys play with a different skill set. we've had, just going back through my tenure, we've had guys that were pure pocket guys guys that have been able to use their feet in the run game, in designed runs, or reading pressures off the edge, use their feet as a weapon in scrambles. And we've had guys that have fallen somewhere in between. We've had 6'3 guys, and we've had 5'10 the last couple of years at UCF. It's about the makeup and the guy inside as much as it is anything. How competitive are they? I think that's extremely important. It drives them every day. What is their ability to react and respond to adverse situations? Can they wipe the slate clean from the previous play? Can they handle all the noise and all the pressure that's going on around them, not just on game day, but in everyday life as they walk through campus? Can they meet the expectations and the work habits that you have to have? So all of those little things add up to a guy playing at a championship level at that position. And if you're going to chase championships, you better have a championship quarterback.
Back to the screen in the back, David Pascal.
Josh, congratulations. David Pascal down here at Chattanooga Times Free Press. For those of us that obviously didn't follow you every day at UCF, you look at that 28-8 record. I know you were 22-4 those first 2 years and 6-4 this past year. There were obviously external factors that everybody had to deal with in college football, but why did this last team not quite have that resounding success that your first two teams did?
Yeah, all of our games except for one loss were one possession games, really tight ball games. This past year, and everybody in America was dealing with it. COVID was a unique situation unto itself, and how you brought your football team back, what were their workouts while they were away from you, when did you actually get your entire team back, what did your practice habits look like. For us, we didn't meet until the fourth game of the season, I think, as far as being in a full team meeting that wasn't virtual. We lost some close ones, I think you look at the beginning of the season, I think we had close to 10 opt-outs, and all those came because of different reasons and different challenges that they faced in their backgrounds. Some of them might be a parent that was ill. Some of them had young children, just different backgrounds. And as the season wore on, I thought we got thinner as a football team and lost a couple of close ones to some good football teams.
Two more questions for Coach. We'll go to Austin Price.
Coach Austin Price, SpaultQuest.com. Every coach that's sit up here in the last 12 years or so, every time they've had a coaching change, has talked about closing the borders. How important is it more so just to make sure Tennessee's a focus more so? Because, kids are going to leave the state, and it's impossible to sign up 25 kids from one state. So how important is it just more to make this a focus than it is necessarily to close the borders? And then, two, how much will you reach out as an alum of Oklahoma, how much will you reach out to the alums of Tennessee, the former football players that you may know through crossing paths with over the years, to make sure they feel like, hey, you guys are always welcome here, the door is always open to come to practice, to come do all those type of things?
If you play football here, you're welcome back here. I don't care if that's spring practice. I don't care if it's observing a workout. I want you guys around. I want them around our football program. It's important to me. I hope, you know, when we get back to having spring games, I'm assuming that there's an event that surrounds that weekend, you know, for former players, that a golfing outing, you know, coming to the game. I want guys here, guys that are currently playing. Hopefully they come back and they're working out here during the off season. Those are all things that I think are important. They give back to the players that are here, you know, and so hopefully that does happen. Will I reach out to them? Absolutely. Your first question was the recruiting question, right, on closing the borders?
Yeah. That's the main focus.
Yeah, I didn't know that everyone had sat up here and said close the borders, but I do believe, like, I'd like to close the borders, right, not let any of them out. Is it going to be a focus? It absolutely will be a focus for us. That's the challenge for myself, for our coaching staff, to make contact with those guys and make sure they understand the importance that they have inside of our program and the opportunity that they have inside of our program too. And you know, is today being day one for me, right? You know, giving them a clear vision of what we anticipate this looking like when you're here.
One more question for Coach Wes Rucker.
Hey, Josh, I know that, you know, the Tennessee program historically, I think maybe one of the 10 or so winningest programs in major college history, but hadn't, for maybe 12, 13 years now, hadn't been a consistent winner. Did you have to maybe call some colleagues, some friends across the country to make sure that they still believed you could win big at a place like this, or was that not a factor in your mind?
I think all the elements to win here are here. You are the biggest show, right? You walk out in that stadium and there's 100,000+ fans inside the stadium. Your facilities are as good as there are in the entire country. You're going to get a world-class education. So a lot of the infrastructure that you need to be successful is absolutely here. Now it's about putting the right people in place to reach our young people so that we can have sustainable success here. I certainly believe that. Having competed against them in the past, having watched them from afar, having talked to coaches that have been inside of this program in recent history.
Thank you very much, Coach.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Thanks, guys.
Questions for Director of Athletics, Danny White, now. Start here in the room.
Danny, you said you did not want to hire Josh, but at what point during your search did you start to have the conversations with him about this job?
It actually wasn't till recent. Don probably hates me right now because I kind of put them in a pretty quick. The more I visited with, and I say this with the utmost amount of respect, with candidates and just vetted the very best coach, not just in a vacuum, but for our set of circumstances here. The brand of football that I think that my sense is that our fans are looking for, but more importantly, what the student athletes are really craving, and what they shared with me, I kind of realized that the best option is the guy that I've been working with for the last 3 years.
Up front here to David.
When you look at Josh's accomplishments at UCF and the challenges that are ahead of you guys here, what sort of things do you feel like are going to translate really well here, and what things do you think you might have to change a little bit?
I mean, I think a lot of what's been happening at UCF is going to translate really well here. What's been accomplished there by a whole lot of people is pretty phenomenal. So I see nothing but opportunity here. I think last week, Chancellor talked a lot about building, and we were a part of building something pretty young at UCF, and that's going to continue to grow. I know it will. New leadership will continue that path. We're excited about, I know Josh and I, we talked yesterday about building this thing back to where it was not that long ago and restoring an iconic brand.
Up front to Jimmy.
Danny, are you a patient person, and do you feel like you'll have to show patience during this rebuilding of the football program?
It's a great question. I think I am impatient, but I have to show patience. Our fans have to show patience. We don't know what success looks like next year or the year after. There are a lot of challenges. I know that our kids want to compete at a high level next year. I know that our head coach wants to compete at a high level next year. I do too. And we're going to go out there and try to win every single football game. But we have to understand that the challenges that we're facing in terms of the competitive level of where we've been, obviously the investigation and some of the unknowns there. But I looked our student athletes in the eyes on Saturday and said, I'm going to go hire a football coach that I think gives you the best opportunity to win next season. They said, please do not hire somebody that you think is going to be good 3 or 4 years from now. I said, I won't do that. So we want to win right away, but we all need to be have some things in perspective and understand that Josh and the staff he's going to build, their focus is going to be on being competitors from day one, but also building this thing for the long haul, like I talked about last week, consistently competitive and build it in a way where it's sustainable, build it the right way, do all the things that we've talked about, being student-athlete-centered and extremely competitive.
Brent and Trey?
Yeah, similar question to what I asked Coach. From your perspective, hiring him as a coordinator to be a first-time head coach, how have you seen Josh change over the last 3 years as a head coach? And secondly, was there anything in this search that maybe surprised you or you found to be unexpected in the short, quick search that you got done?
I mean, you learn a lot through every experience, life experience, professional experience. Is Josh a better coach than he was 3 years ago? Heck yeah, he's grown a lot. I've grown a lot as an athletic director. I think the experiences we go through make us better. This press conference is going to make me better. But that's why, you know, as we go through a search, we value those experiences. And we value people that have been a head coach and have kind of walked in those shoes. I lost track of your...
On the quick search the last few days, was there anything...
That surprised me.
Surprise, but anything that maybe you didn't anticipate or didn't expect in the search?
Yeah, you know, talking about experiences again, going through several searches... What I've learned is you really can't have expectations because you don't know where you're going to land. As I said at the beginning of this, I did not expect to hire Josh Heupel, not because I don't think he's one heck of a football coach. I wouldn't be standing here if I didn't think that. But I really didn't want to do that to UCF. And I'm going to have I know I have some people mad at me right now. I love y'all. I promise. I love UCF. And I want the very best for that place that's been so good to me and my family and I love the people there. But searches are fluid, and you need to take all the information you can. And as I said last week, I am far from the smartest person in the room, but I was extremely close to this, and I'm moderately intelligent, and I worked really hard to make the best decision that I think is in the best interest of Tennessee, knowing everything I had learned from student-athletes, from our leadership, from information I gained from key alumni and donors and just try to make the right fit. It's about fit. And sometimes it's not just a location thing. It's a status of the program thing. It's a status of the roster thing. It's a leadership thing. There's so many factors that go into fit. And at the end of the day, in my assessment, this is the very best fit for us. Josh Heupel is going to do a heck of a job as our head football coach, and I couldn't be more excited to have him here.
Trey, then Blake.
Danny, when you went through this coaching search and the NCAA investigation that's currently ongoing, a lot of Tennessee fans now think, okay, you have a football coach. Now what's next when it comes to the violations? How do we handle this? How do we build this football program with this cloud hanging over? What was the response on the trail to the stuff like this that has been coming up? And how did you think Coach Heupel took it when you told him maybe the ramifications that might be coming?
You know, I had the same questions 2 weeks ago when I was assessing coming to Knoxville and being a part of what I mentioned last week was a long-term, unbelievable opportunity to restore this brand and do some really great work here. This is a short-term problem. And I think our leadership has done a phenomenal job of identifying the issue, working with, no offense to any other law firm that works with the NCAA, but I think the very best law firm that works on these sorts of things with the NCAA, and being extremely proactive and very transparent with NCAA staff. So I think we're attacking it head on and above board, And by doing it that way, I think we're going to get through it. I say fairly quickly in comparison to maybe some other examples that we've seen historically in college athletics. This is a short-term issue, and we expect to put it in the rearview mirror as soon as possible and continue to move forward. But that doesn't stop us from building our long-term vision now and for starting to build the foundation now while managing, I think our new football coach called it a speed bump. I like that. It's a speed bump.
Blake?
Yeah, Danny, you mentioned in your opening remarks that Josh was your top candidate. If he was your top candidate, why didn't the search start there, and why did it ultimately turn in that direction?
Because I didn't have a top candidate at the beginning of the search. I think I said last week, you guys are all candidates. I don't start a coaching search with a specific end game in mind. I don't think that's smart. I think that I need to, I learn as I go through a search. I learn before I start interviewing people. I didn't interview or talk to a single candidate until I had gained as much information as I could, as until I had met with our student athletes and learned a ton from them. But then as I go through those interviews, I learn from those interviews. And I can I pick up some things. I mean, we interview good people. They're smart people too. They know more about football than I do. So I learned about their opinion of our situation, and I could kind of compare all those conversations. And all of that information led to the decision that I made, and I couldn't feel better about it.
We'll take some virtual questions. Mike Wilson.
Yeah, Danny, on the investigation, did you mm-hmm. try to talk to the NCAA to get any extra insight into maybe what punishments could await? And then were you also aware at any point previously or during this of Tennessee fans' love of tracking planes during coaching?
I know that they tracked a plane that took my family back. My kids had to go to school, so I will say that had nothing to do with the search. But I'm pretty sure that they paid attention in class this week. So I want our fans to know that. I went off on a sidebar. I lost your first question. I'm sorry.
No, you're good. Did you attempt to gain any extra insight from the NCAA or the legal yeah. firm into the potential ramifications before you hired Josh?
I didn't talk to the NCAA directly. I don't think they need the fundraising, marketing focused, hard charging AD. I wouldn't understand what they're saying to me. People way smarter than me talked to them and briefed me. So I was able to talk to coaches about the set of circumstances that we're forecasting. We don't know exactly what's going to happen, but our we have between the outside counsel we're working with and our compliance folks that have a ton of experience in that area, they're having those conversations and educating me about it.
Mike Bianchi.
Yeah, Danny, how important do you think it was for Tennessee to act quickly to hire you and then for you to act quickly to hire Josh? And secondly, Scott Carr has been named your interim replacement at UCF. What does he bring to the table?
I think it was really important. I think it's a strong sign of smart leadership. And actually, John Hitt, President Hitt, retired president at UCF, did the same thing, hired me there to then hire a football coach. We've talked quite a bit over the last couple of weeks about the alignment of our leadership, but good leadership, strong leaders hire people to do their jobs. And I've received nothing but unbelievable support throughout this search and since I raised my hand to come here to Knoxville. And I think hiring an athletic director, hire a football coach is the way it should be done. I feel unbelievably honored to be empowered to manage this athletics department, lead this athletics department into hopefully a really prosperous and bright future. Scott Carr is a talented leader. I'm excited for him. I talked to him just a short while ago. UCF has an incredibly bright future. Mike, I know you know that. It's really hard. It was really hard for me to leave. It's really hard, I know, for Josh to leave. We talked about it. We love that place, and I know it's going to continue. It's going to continue to grow. Scott's going to do a great job for him, and I'm going to help in any way I can. President Cartwright is an unbelievable leader, and I told him last night, anything that I can to help in this transition. Now that I'm through the search, I'm 100% on board to help them in any way I can be of assistance.
Two more virtual questions. We'll go to Gustavo, WUTK Radio.
Danny, it's a pleasure speaking to you. What is the responsibility that Josh brings here to Rocky Top, especially being hired after, you know, the previous four coaches didn't work in the last 13 years? What is his responsibility to bring this program back?
What I told our team this morning, I mentioned earlier about restoring an iconic brand in college sports. I think any successful organization, that starts internally. It starts with those kids. And it starts as we build, as he builds a staff, it grows to that staff. And then it grows to the rest of our athletics department and all of our supporters, our university leadership, our fans and donors. But you got to start, at the most important is with those student athletes. And make sure that we're doing the right things every day to maximize who they can be, and that we're recruiting at the right way to bring new kids in to be a part of what we're doing. That's what we did at UCF. You can't start a marketing campaign to sell out a stadium or to win football games. You got to be really good and really true to walking the walk and following through with what you say you want to be. And I know that's what he'll do, and that's his ultimate responsibility.
Two more questions. Kellyanne Virtually.
Hey, Danny. Kellyanne Sint with WATE-TV here in Knoxville. Well, in your introductory press conference, you preached positivity to fans. With the new hire as head coach, there's been some negative responses on Twitter, but what is your message to fans today?
Some of you are awesome. Some of you are failing right now. Why would we be negative? The future of this place is unbelievably exciting and positive, and I couldn't be more excited to be here. And I see nothing but great days ahead. So I know that our fans are extremely passionate. I love that. I can't wait to get to know many of them and work with them. I can't get to know them all because there's so many of them. But the idea of turning your passion into something that you love into negativity, I don't understand that. But I think that this athletics department has been through some challenges. And we have really great days ahead. And I think that people will see that and start having some more fun with their Vol fanship.
One last question here in the room. Jimmy?
COVID has certainly created a lot of financial hardships on athletic departments. There are assistant coaches who have at least a year left on their contract. Will Coach Heupel be asked to keep anybody, or does he have a clean slate on who he can hire on his staff?
What I mentioned earlier about our leadership empowering me to run our athletics department, I don't know anything about running a football program. This guy does, and he's got a proven track record of doing it. So all those decisions will be his as our head football coach.
That concludes today's press conference. Thank you very much for joining us today.
All right. Thank you all for being here.
Go Vols. Go Big Orange, right?
Go Big Orange.